understand.
You don't understand?
No.
Hmm. Well, just memorize it, and later on, you'll understand it.
If I told you my story, you would hear hope that wouldn't let go. And if I told you my story, you would hear love that never gave up. And if I told you my story, you would hear life, but it wasn't mine. If I should speak, then let it be of the grace that is greater than all my sin, of when justice was served and when mercy wins, of the kindness of Jesus that draws. Told you my story, you would hear freedom was won for me. And if I told you my story, you would hear life overcome the grave. If I should speak, to guide my name on a stone written down. Darling, it's this same, it's where I'm living now. Yeah, we always knew that the day would come, 'cause all we had was a spark. But one day soon, when the sparks all bloom and they're chasing back the dark, I'm gonna see you again on a gold street, standing next to me, I know. Gonna see you again, darling, won't be long till every trace of trouble is gone. We'll be together and I'm not sure what that means, but I know it'll be better than we ever dreamed. Gonna see you again. So we wait for now till the day has arrived. When we meet once more, bet I'll say something like, I always knew you could be like this. I saw flashes and glimpses before, but they fade, they seem like a distant dream. Now you walk into the door. When I see you again on a gold street, standing next to me, I know. Gonna see you again, darling, won't be long till every trace of trouble is gone. We'll be together and I'm not sure what that means, but I know it'll be better than we ever dreamed. Leave behind so much left to say, but we'll have time, 'cause with forever there's another day. Leave behind so much left to say, but we'll have time, 'cause with forever there's another day. When I see you again on a gold street, standing next to me, I know. Gonna see you again, darling, won't be long till every trace of trouble is gone. Be together and I'm not sure what that means, but I know better than we ever dreamed. Be together and I'm not sure what that means, but I know better than we ever dreamed. When I see you again, gonna see you again.
Especially when it comes to you, my friend. You have taught me to slow down and to prop up my feet. It's the fine art of being who I am. And I can't figure out why you want me around. Not the smartest person I have ever met, but somehow that doesn't matter. No, it never really mattered to you at all. And at the risk of wearing out my welcome, at the risk of self-discovery, sit at home, you're a loser. Couldn't you find anything better to do? gather in one place and know each other and love each other well. And I wish we could all go camping and lay beneath the stars and have nothing to do and stories to tell. We'd sit around the campfire and we'd make each other laugh, remembering when. And you're the first one I'm inviting. Always know that you're invited, my friend. And at the risk of
I love Pisgah because the teachers are always there to answer your questions and help you understand.
Mr. Rear, can you help me with number 42?
Number 42. Oh, yes. I think I remember this. The ionic substances are in equilibrium with each other. And because of that, the closed system opens and out pops the bear. And the bear says, hello.
Understand.
You don't understand?
No.
Well, just memorize it, and later on, you'll understand it.
If I told you my story, you would hear hope that wouldn't let go. And if I told you my story, you would hear love that never gave up. And if I told you my story, you would hear life, but it wasn't mine. If I should speak, then let it be of the grace that is greater than all my sin, of when justice was served and when mercy.
You may be seated. Thank you.
Thank you so much, each and every one of you, for being here today. Welcome you to an opportunity this afternoon to celebrate someone special in the hearts and lives of each one of us as we celebrate the life of George Grow. To George's family, we especially continue to lift you up in our prayers. And for students, staff, faculty, colleagues, friends, and church family, thank you so much for being here this afternoon. So we have an opportunity to look around and see those who have gathered. This is a reflection of, I'm sure, many years, decades of the ripples of George's life. But I invite us to take a moment, pause for prayer here, as we also recognize our God who is in our midst and with us in a special way at this time as well. Will you pray with me? Precious Father God, I want to thank you so much for this opportunity to come to you. And Lord, many of us may still feel the shock in our hearts of the reason for this gathering. We come to you, Father, as the God of all comfort, the good shepherd who gave his life for his sheep. We come to you now asking you to fill us with your presence. Give us your peace and your strength. Give us the blessed hope that is found in our Savior. Fill our hearts with the courage, all that we need as we gather here. May we gain strength from each other, Lord God. May we gain hope from your word, comfort from one another's presence, but most of all, may we have this opportunity to celebrate this amazing person that you blessed our lives with in George Grow. Father, we seek your blessing upon this time. May you be with each one here as they reflect on the memories, the times shared, and what George means to each and every one of us. Be present with us, Lord. Be glorified through this, and may your Holy Spirit be felt. We pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen. George had a love for music, and especially a great opportunity in these last few years to be with the Hominy Valley Men's Christian Acapella Choir under the direction of Clay Plemons. And thank you, gentlemen, for being here today to bless us with music. Turn the time over to you.
They asked me to say a few words, and if they know me, they know that I can't say a few words. I asked George on the way home the other night after our concert, I said, George, did I talk too much? He said, no. Well, maybe a little. That's the way George was. I wasn't fortunate enough to have him as a teacher, but I had him as a student, and if you had him as a teacher, just know that he was the biggest cut-up in the chorus. Not more than once did I have to call him and Tim down for over here for cutting jokes and making fun. It was a continuous thing with George. But he loved the choir. He loved the singing, and he loved the harmony. And he loved the fact that the camaraderie of the men. Today, there's a space right here, that's George's space. It'll be here today.
Awesome wonder. Mr. George, whenever we sing in rehearsal, quite often George would jump up and say, "Oh, let me tell you a story." It's probably never happened to you, eh? And he's always saying, "What a wretch we are, an amazing grace." I looked at George, he was the kindest, gentlest man I've ever known. But maybe we need Jesus Christ. Thank you.
First verse, a cappella, and then we're going to do the second and third verse with Kevin, and then the fourth verse, we'd like for y'all to stand and sing it with us.
One, two, three, four. You know, this could be a really short life sketch. He was born and raised in Ohio, went to Andrews University, and then moved down here to North Carolina, and he's been here ever since. But to me, at least, the life sketch is the most interesting part of a funeral or memorial service, and doubly so when it is a person you love and admire. So I know you will want more. And I'm prepared to give as much detail as I reasonably can. Obviously, this is not easy. I have backup. But his was a remarkable life, rich and full and blessed by God. And with the right telling, one can see God's handiwork time after time in his story. May God be praised. By the way, I ask for your forgiveness if in advance for any errors or omissions. We're all getting older, and our memories are not perfect, and neither has been our record keeping. George Lee Grow was born on August 13, 1945, in Columbus, Ohio. Just 2 days after and about 64 miles away from the birth of his future wife, Linda Fries, who was born in Bucyrus, Ohio. By the way, this date happened to be the day before VJ Day, the day the Japanese surrendered in World War II. The day after his birth, his parents could hear cheering in the streets outside the hospital room, celebrating the end of the war. His father was George Clinton Grow. So George was not a junior, even though his father was also George, because they had different middle names. His mother was Louise Yingling Grow. He was their only child by intention. George's parents were poor. His father was a painter and a wallpaper hanger. Louise was taking the nursing program at Mount Vernon, but that was interrupted when she got married, and she never finished her nursing degree. George grew up in a small house that was really a converted garage near Newark, Ohio. His parents were Seventh-day Adventists, and when it came time for him to go to school, they sent him to the Newark Church School, which was a two-room school and went up to grade 9. At some point during grade school, his parents finally realized that George needed glasses. Up until then, he seemed to be doing fine, although in reality, he couldn't see the blackboard in his classroom and was just figuring things out in his head. But one day during camp meeting, he complained that he didn't want to go to the meeting because you can't even see the people on the platform. His mother said, "What? You can't see the people on the stage?" And so they took him to get his vision tested and got him glasses to correct his severe nearsightedness. I can remember when, sometime in the 80s or 90s, he switched to contact lenses. And it was a real change in his appearance because up until then, he always had glasses on. A couple of other stories from his childhood illustrate the hand of God in his life. In his Sabbath school class, the children were awarded some sort of animal figurine if they achieved some goal, probably involving memory verses. One day, the prize was given to another child, and little Georgie, as his mother called him, was upset that he hadn't gotten it. He was so upset that he had to be sent out of the room. His pastor encountered him in a stairwell and could see that he was upset, and he stopped and took the time to calmly and kindly talk to him and explain why things were the way they were and until he could understand that it was right. The pastor's kind way of dealing with him left an impression that stayed with him and undoubtedly influenced his way of dealing with students. Also, sometime in his childhood, his family took a long road trip all the way down to Florida to visit some family members. And they stopped along the way in Asheville and spent the night in the sanitarium just up there on the hill where the guest facility is now, on the campus of Mount Pisgah Academy. The beauty of the campus, as well as the Great Smoky Mountains, and the kindness of the people here, left another lasting impression on George that years later played a factor in his choosing Mount Pisgah Academy for his first employment. After George finished ninth grade at the Newark Grade School, his parents sent him 30 miles away to Mount Vernon Academy to start his sophomore year. They were close enough that they could visit him every Sabbath afternoon and bring him his clean laundry. He attended Mount Vernon for 3 years. He was a friendly and likable person who seemed to get along with all the differing social factions one finds at the high school level. And as a result, he was chosen class president both his junior and senior years. And by the way, his graduating class had 95 members. His main interest in high school was music. He was in the choir as well as a male quartet and traveled quite a bit with those groups. He worked in the academy laundry that provided commercial laundry service for the nearby hospital. And he also was a dorm worker. Among his responsibilities was getting up early to ring the rising bell every morning. George was tall, as we all know. His father was also tall. His father grew up loving basketball. In high school, he was a member of the school basketball team, and it was his whole life. But he fell afoul of the school rules when it was discovered that he was also playing for a church team, and he was kicked off the school team. Basketball was all he really cared about, so when he couldn't play on the school team, he dropped out of school, and he never finished high school. Years later, when he had a son, he was so concerned about the poor decision that he had made due to his love of basketball that he counseled young George to stay away from basketball and, in fact, sports in general. As a result, George, who was clearly sized to be a basketball star, never had any interest in sports. Music was his interest. He dated a little in high school, but mostly just wanted to be friends with everybody. After graduation from Mount Vernon, George went on to Andrews University. He knew he wanted to be a teacher in the area of science, so he became a chemistry major. But his real love was still music. He was in a singing group that was kind of modeled after the popular trio Peter, Paul, and Mary. The other male in the group, by the way, just happened to be Johnny Waller, the son of Dr. Waller, who was a fixture in this church. Their singing group became quite popular and traveled extensively. George was a popular person, and he caught Linda Freese's eye during their freshman year at Andrews. But she was unsuccessful at attracting his attention until their sophomore year. Finally, he asked her out for a date to a beach party put on by Frank Knittel, who was on the faculty at Andrews and went on to become the president of Southern College. At the beach party there on the shore of Lake Michigan, in spite of George's being popular and involved in a lot of music there on the beach, he and Linda hit it off. And after that, they started dating pretty consistently, what we used to call going steady. To spend more time together, they would go to a practice room in the music building, and George would practice his guitar and banjo while Linda would attempt to study to keep up with her classes. That kind of demonstrates that his focus was still on music more than on academics. As their senior year came, George and Linda planned to get married, but they were still too poor to be able to. In the spring, George started getting feelers from schools looking for teachers. He got 4 calls, including Mount Pisgah Academy, Blue Mountain Academy in Pennsylvania, Kettering Junior Academy in Ohio, one other school. Kettering might have made the most sense because it was closest to home, but being a 10th grade school, it would not have offered him the opportunity to teach the classes he wanted to teach, so he really didn't consider that. He was most interested in Mount Pisgah Academy because of the positive feelings he still had from his childhood visit there. The principal at the time, Jim Shepherd, came up to Andrews and interviewed him. And then George and Linda flew down to MPA in a small plane with George's suite mate, who was a pilot and had access to one of the planes from the Andrews Aviation Program. They liked what they saw at MPA and agreed to take the job. Mount Pisgah Academy expected George to teach chemistry, biology, and math classes. But there were a couple of problems. First, George had not actually taken a biology class in college. So he signed up for biology class that spring or summer with Dr. Hare so he could teach biology at MPA. This is ironic, as you all can tell, because throughout his career at MPA, biology appeared to most of us who knew him to be his greatest academic love. Second, his grades in math classes in college hadn't been good enough, and he didn't have enough credits to graduate. So, in truth, he was hired by Mount Pisgah Academy without a college degree. He had to go back the summer after his first year teaching and finish up some math classes so he could get his diploma. Linda graduated from Andrews University on August 15, 1968. Their 23rd birthdays had just passed by on the 11th and the 13th. 3 days after graduation, on August 18, they were married at a church in Alma, Michigan. Linda's father, Harry Freese, was an SDA pastor and had three churches in the area, but while Alma was not one of his churches, that church had a fellowship hall which they could use for the reception. After all the hoopla of the wedding died down, they proceeded to Lansing, where the bridal suite in a hotel was reserved for them. When they arrived, they found to their dismay that the room had not been cleaned. Not only was it not fit for habitation, but the hotel had no other rooms available. So in desperation, they searched the town and found a room in a cheap motel where they crashed in exhaustion after a tumultuous few days. The next day, they drove down to North Carolina and rented a cabin in the Smokies for a few days, making it to MPA in time for pre-week teachers' meetings before the start of classes. His first year of teaching at MPA was difficult, but he learned that he truly enjoyed teaching, and he was determined to keep at it. As the years went by and he became a popular teacher, calls would come from other schools, including one to Far Eastern Academy in Singapore. However, he and Linda were pretty committed to Mount Pisgah Academy and refused all the invitations. And eventually, the calls stopped coming. For years, George was the primary science and math teacher at MPA. He generally taught chemistry, biology, algebra, geometry, and algebra 2. We tried to make an exhaustive list of all the classes he ever taught at MPA, and here's what we came up with, in addition to those five already mentioned. Advanced biology, sometimes known as AP biology, photography, driver's ed, trigonometry, one portion of physics in a team teaching arrangement, earth science, possibly physical science, we're not sure, yearbook, and AV media, which was the class leading up to Remembrances, the end of the year media show. In addition, he may have been given a Bible class one semester, and he served as the dean of Hilltop for a time. When I arrived at MPA in 1977 as a math teacher, George was glad to see me because it meant he wouldn't be teaching math anymore. Math was not his favorite. George resisted the common pull on popular teachers to move into administration. He had no interest in being a principal. His love was in the classroom. Incidentally, our research indicated that George endured at least 9 different principals during his tenure at MPA. Possibly 1 or 2 more, I'm not sure. George worked on his master's degree, taking classes in the evenings and the summers, and finally graduated in the summer of 1979 with a Master of Arts in Education with an emphasis in biology from Western Carolina University in Cullowhee. After his master's was finished, their summers were freed up for travel. For a number of years, George and Linda directed summer geology tours. It began with the Carolina Conference sponsoring him to lead the tour for conference elementary teachers who needed certification credits, and later moved under the auspices of Southern Adventist University. These tours involved car caravans and camping, traveling to western and southwestern places such as the Grand Canyon, Yellowstone, visiting states such as Wyoming, Montana, Utah, Arizona. If they weren't on a geology tour, they were generally spending their summers traveling to those places anyway because those were the places they loved to visit. George was a strong believer in the biblical account of creation, and he loved researching and teaching the evidences of creation and the flood that he could see in the geological record. As teaching duties changed, Linda found herself teaching earth science, largely on the strength of having learned from George.
I actually get to read a paragraph.
Could be more.
From early on in their relationship, George and Linda mutually agreed that they would choose not to have children. Some of the reasons were personal, and we won't go into them, but one reason in George's mind was that he wanted to be able to devote himself to his students. He felt that if he had children of his own, they might detract from the time he could give to his students, or vice versa. It happened that John and I also married with the same commitment not to have children, which was just one of the many reasons that we hit it off with George and Linda and became friends. We did a lot together, spending Sabbath afternoons exploring, finding old churches and singing hymns in 4-part harmony. Sorry. That was such a good memory. We would sit in these old churches and we would find hymns and we would sing together in 4-part harmony.
Also, we noticed over there on the table, which you need to come up and look at, there was a box of Milborn, the game. We used to play Milborn a lot.
Hours, coup foray, we would say, when we would get a good hand. Anyway, we would sing together. We went camping, hiking, and four-wheeling. Then 15 years after John and I got married, the Lord worked a miracle in our hearts, and we decided to have a child. But we were concerned that perhaps George and Linda would feel some sense of rejection or that it might affect our friendship. But of course, they were gracious and welcomed our son Mark warmly in 1993 and showed him much love and kindness throughout their lives and continue to, and actually saw Mark just recently, stopped in, deliberately made a point of visiting with Mark at Union College in Lincoln, where Mark is living and working. For their part, Linda's nephew Cliff became like a son to them. He lived with them while attending MPA until his graduation in 1980. Tears in my eyes, the numbers are blurring. And as he grew up, he got married and had a family of his own. His children, Jenna and Taylor, have become George and Linda's unofficial grandchildren.
As has been said, George was devoted to teaching, but he did find time away from the classroom to devote to pursuits, to pursue interests and hobbies. He always loved cars, from their famous Plymouth Roadrunner to the beloved Toyota Land Cruisers. He was a rabid Toyota fan. One of his favorite slogans was, "Friends don't let friends drive Nissans." This caused a little awkwardness when I bought a Nissan Leaf but he was eventually able to swallow his pride and come to terms with it. He was also a big NASCAR fan. Of course, music was a major interest, whether it was performing, singing, guitar, banjo, or listening. He always had a fine sound system and an ever-growing collection of music, ranging from classical to contemporary Christian. Another major hobby was bird watching. Many of George and Linda's trips around the U.S. were planned with birds in mind, specifically going to places where they hoped to see new birds to add to their life list. Here's a story that indicates the importance of the life list. One summer, they had driven their Toyota 4Runner to California. They were living in the 4Runner, and it contained all their summer possessions. One memorable day, they went to the San Diego Zoo. At the end of the day, they came back to the parking lot to discover their 4Runner had been stolen. They lost everything. Needless to say, it was a very difficult time for them. But out of all the loss and inconvenience, one of their greatest, most irreplaceable losses was their birding life list, gone with the car. Since then, of course, they've started a new list, and Linda assures me that they've probably surpassed the old one. Finally, photography was one of George's great passions, and Linda's too. From his early work with Yearbook through the Remembrances and AV Media years, George was often seen with a camera in hand. Birds, geology, nature photography in general, he's got a lot of pictures. There comes a point where the sheer mass of pictures becomes a burden. He imagined that in retirement he would have time to get a handle on his vast collection. But that didn't keep them from continuing to be avid photographers and continue adding to their collection. George's father passed away back in Newark, Ohio in 1995 at the age of 89. His mother, Louise, lived by herself for a number of years until coming down to North Carolina and moving in with Linda and George. She lived with them until going into assisted living for a year or two and passed away in 2015. George and Linda lived in campus housing nearly their entire career. In advance of retirement, they realized they would need their own home after retirement, so they started looking. The Lord led them to a home in the Candor area, just a couple of miles from here, that they were able to purchase in 2010. It had enough room to accommodate Louise as well. As the primary science teacher, George had a remarkable string of wonderful student workers. From his very first reader in 1968, who was Cindy Matteson, who later married Haskell Williams, through numerous workers to his final worker before he retired, Becca Doying, if my research is correct, he just seemed, from my vantage point as a teaching colleague anyway, to have the best quality workers. Whether it was his ability to spot talent or his ability to bring out the best in his workers, I can't say which. But it was, as I say, remarkable. And I believe it's a significant reflection on his own character. In 2011, George retired after 43 years of service to Mount Pisgah Academy. George was not so much eager to leave the classroom, but one of the benefits of retirement that he was looking forward to was the freedom to travel during other parts of the year than just summers. George was honored with a retirement banquet in April, at which time the principal, Rick Anderson, announced the designation of the lab classroom in the Ad Building as the George Grow Science Lab. At graduation, George was asked by the class of 2011 to be their commencement speaker, a sign of the tremendous respect and love that they had for him. After 43 years of teaching, you can be sure that there are many, many stories that can be told. I've seen a great many heartfelt, touching comments over the last few days on the Facebook group. From his pet peeve of crumpled up paper, to taking students for rides exceeding 125 miles an hour in the old Roadrunner on the newly opened and thus largely empty I-40, to his mentoring students in their love of nature and of Jesus, there's no end of stories. I'm going to deviate for just a moment to read you one that I just read yesterday. It was just posted yesterday. This is by Mark Kendall. Mark, are you here? Can I read this? Thank you. The reason I'm reading this is because I think it gives a special insight into the kind of teacher that George was. My heart, Mark says, my heart aches for the Grow family and for all of us that had a moment with such a kind-hearted mentor. Mentors are rare. Mr. Grow was the rarest. I was only at MPA for 2 years, but he is a big piece of my memories. My son attended too, and guess what? Mr. Grow has a large part of his memories as well. One particular memory stands out to me. I was in his chemistry class, which I found fascinating, but this particular morning I fell asleep on my desk during his lecture. Class dismissed and my friends moved on to the next period class and left me there sleeping. I'm sure they thought that was pretty funny. At some point I woke up and when I raised my head, it was just Mr. Grow at the desk grading papers and me in a silent room. I gathered my books and started to make my exit, but he stopped me and asked me if I had a minute to talk. You don't say no, so in my embarrassment, I stood there waiting for my reprimand. Instead, he said something like, I bet you've had a long week, but we covered some important things today. Be sure you get notes from a classmate. Also, you should take every moment in life to be curious. If you will be curious, you will find success. I've long since forgotten periodic chart details and science lab findings, but I never forgot his words to be curious. I did take that to heart, and it has served me well. He was 100% correct. I've been blessed to provide training to many, many new employees through the years, and I've always told them to be curious. I have quoted him and thought of him countless times. I can hear his voice encouraging all of us to be curious. Mr. Grow, I will. Now, I want to remind you that before I deviated there, the last thing I said was, I mentioned his mentoring students and their love of nature and of Jesus. That brings up one more extremely important aspect of George, possibly the most important of all. He had a deep concern for young people. It was way more than just a job, and it was way more than just biology or chemistry. He wanted them to know Jesus. His students could see that. Whether or not they ultimately made the choice to follow Jesus, they came away from their classes with George knowing that they had been given a glimpse of God's love. And they respected him for that. Now's where it gets hard. After retirement, George and Linda went off in their trusty 95 cruiser on an extended road trip, reveling in the fact that they didn't have to be back by August 1, and could go visit some bird migrations they had never been able to see before. Their tour eventually took them to their relatives' places in Montana and Colorado, where Linda started feeling poorly. She got to feeling worse and worse until they decided it would be wise to head for home. It's a long drive from Colorado to North Carolina. As they drove, the situation got more and more alarming, and George started calling on his cell phone for advice. I remember he called my wife at one point. He tried calling Linda's physician, but it was Sunday, so all he got was the answering service, who could do no better than recommend that they go to the nearest emergency room. It happened that at that moment, they were stuck in stop-and-go traffic just east of Nashville, Tennessee. And they were approaching an exit that just happened to have a sign for a hospital. So George quickly took the exit and headed for the hospital. At the emergency room, it didn't take too long for the doctor to come back with a devastating diagnosis: leukemia. Providentially, this hospital was connected to a hospital system with one of the nation's top cancer centers, the Sarah Cannon Cancer Center, right there in Nashville. Linda was moved there. As she considered treatment options, she asked the physician about the viability of pursuing a holistic or naturopathic treatment. His response, that she might have just weeks or even days to live if she chose such a plan, convinced her to accept the recommendation of more aggressive therapy, including radiation and chemo. I won't go into the details of the ensuing ordeal, except to note the huge outpouring of love, support, and prayers from many, many friends and former students, along with family. But in roughly a year, after a harrowing course of treatment, she was finally sent home and has been declared cancer-free. God does not promise us freedom from the effects of evil in this world. And he does not always take away cancer, as he did in this case. But he is always with us, even through such trauma. And in this case, his hand can be seen in so many ways. The timing was such a blessing. What if George had still been teaching? God, in his mercy, allowed George to be retired before having to deal with Linda's horrific illness. He was able to devote 100% of his attention to Linda. God, in his mercy, provided a major cancer center right nearby. God provided one of George's treasured former student workers, Peter Kroll, now a physician in Nashville, to be nearby to bring aid and support to Linda and George. Many, many prayers were answered with Linda's amazing recovery from leukemia. Linda has unfortunately never recovered the full vigor of her pre-leukemia health. She remains somewhat frail and susceptible to minor infections, which is why if you see her at all at church on a Sabbath morning, she's probably wearing a mask. In order to ease the rigors of camping while still enabling the travel that they love, George and Linda bought an RV, which they have enjoyed driving around to their favorite destinations. They've had many wonderful adventures with it. George's commitment to his home church, this church right here, did not end with his retirement. He has long been a leader in this church, serving for many years as head elder, as well as a Sabbath school teacher. He had a strong interest in the health of the church and its relationship to the academy. This past summer, we were blessed with a temporary Bible worker who brought in a number of new people interested in the gospel in our church. Upon the Bible worker's departure, George agreed to continue studies with a couple of them, with whom he met every week or so. On Monday, March 18, George had visits with both of them, and he came home very happy with the time he was able to spend with them. After supper time, he decided to take his car to a car wash, despite the fact that it was cold out and about to get dark. It seemed a little odd, but he didn't say anything to Linda. When he returned, He came in the house, sat down in the chair, and dialed 911. Again, without saying anything to Linda. When the ambulance came, he talked to the EMTs. At first, they didn't think anything was wrong, but they decided to take him to the ER anyway. They waited for Linda to get her things and drive along behind. She followed the ambulance in their Corolla and felt a bit squeamish about racing down I-40 at 80 miles per hour, but figured she'd better stay with them. When they arrived at Mission Hospital's emergency room, they directed her where to park, and she came in. The ER physician ordered an MRI. At that point, George's eyes were closed, and he was not responding. The MRI scan indicated a massive brain bleed. Comfort measures were provided, and he was taken to ICU in the middle of the night. Our phones were unresponsive to calls during the night, so we didn't find out until we awoke Tuesday morning. When we got to the hospital, we found George in an ICU bed with Linda by his side, surrounded by family and friends. He was still unresponsive, but breathing on his own. Linda reported that around noon, he squeezed her hand as she was holding it, but then he seemed to relax and never did so again. After an anointing service with Pastor Jonathan, who anointed Linda, by the way, as well, George was moved to hospice, where he continued to breathe on his own for another approximately 36 hours. Linda spent most of that time holding his hand and talking to him, hoping without any response that he might be hearing her. He stopped breathing early in the morning, Thursday, March 21. You can understand what a shock this was to everyone, most of all to Linda. She was the one with health issues. Any reasonable person would naturally expect her to be the first of the two of them to go. Linda herself was saying over and over that first day, "I was supposed to go first." But life is nothing if not unpredictable. The one assurance that we can take to heart is that God is with us. God has shown himself again and again in the massive outpouring of love and support of family, church family, friends, former students. In yet another stunning sign of God's providence, it was settled just the afternoon before all this happened that Cliff and his wife Joyce will be moving here to live in George and Linda's house with Linda while Joyce teaches one more year at RAPCS before retiring. What a blessing. Linda's immediate future is undecided. Several options are open to her. But her confidence in Jesus remains unshaken. She, along with many others of us, look forward eagerly to being reunited with George in the earth made new. But until then, she remains content to trust her Savior for guidance and strength each day.
Hello, my name is John Van Eyck, and I am Mr. Groh's nephew, or as he called me all through my high school years, his wife's nephew, and to which I replied, "That's my aunt's husband." I'm going to try and get through this. I thought I saw Bridget here. Is Bridget here? I have learned something when speaking at a difficult event. I've learned and was told that if you squeeze your butt cheeks together, it will stop the tears. So we'll see if this works. So if I stop and look really determined on my face, you'll know what I'm doing. I was asked to thank some people, and I definitely want to. First, John and Katie Ratzliff. You know, it's been amazing because when Aunt Linda was sick, I called Kitty and John and wanted to know, should I come back or is she going to be okay? And they talked me through that. She talked me through that. And I've talked with Kitty and John throughout the week, and they helped with the pictures, and it was just been so kind. So you saw that we put them in the family section. That's intentional. That's where they belong. You also may have seen a picture of Peter and Julie Kroll there. They were actually celebrating the 5-year anniversary of being cancer-free. Julie was gracious enough to send that to me. But because they were so kind to my uncle and aunt, they belonged with the family. Zach and Ruthie came today. Zach and Ruthie did remembrances with me and Uncle George many years ago. When Uncle George passed, I got in contact with former members of remembrances, including Jerry Hartman and Brian Fowler, and Tammy Ellis helped, and Alex from the Academy. And they went through pictures, and what was neat about it is Zach set up a drive, and people from all over dropped pictures in there and shared this experience. And it means so much to me that Zachary and Ruthie were able to come and do this today. So you guys are family. And I just wish that the remembrances reunion wasn't in this situation. If you ever served on remembrances, raise your hand. So we got a bunch here. Is that David George in the back? David. And thank you for coming. And of course, everybody did a wonderful job. And the funny thing is, everybody said the same thing. They were sorry it wasn't better. And I said, that's spoken by a bunch of true perfectionists. So, by the way, Uncle George married Ruthie and Zachary, and I still remember him talking to me about what he should say. And he had a joke, and he said, do you know what the difference between in-laws and outlaws is? And of course, no one knew. He said, outlaws are wanted. So I've never forgotten that. I'll have to talk again about remembrances here. Somebody asked Uncle George once, why remembrances? He said, well, it's, you know, remembrance means the act of remembering things. And we're remembering a lot of things, so it just made sense, remembrances. And that's what we're doing today, is coming together to remember. And, you know, some funerals, it's hard sometimes to know good things to say. But I'm happy to know that there was no lack of good things to say about Uncle George. And sometimes, you know, you go to a funeral, like, well, I knew that person. And I just don't recall them being that wonderful. But I'm happy to say that with Uncle George, it was all good. It was all wonderful. It was all beautiful memories. And it has amazed me and touched me all week about people who have reached out and called and written, posted on the Remembering Mr. Grow page, and shared beautiful stories. You stole my story, by the way. It's all good, though. Mark, that was too good of a story. So, but I began to realize something, that in our grief, that we were sharing this common thread with everybody. I work and live on the Navajo reservation. I've been there almost 14 years. In the Navajo culture, there's a teaching called kinship, or keh. And when you do something kind or helpful to a family, you become more than just a friend. You create kinship, which is like being part of the family. And so I realized that through all the years of touching students and touching lives, whether it be at the academy, whether it be in a grade school or here in the church, Uncle George was creating kinship. And that means we're all family. So I want to share some quotes from and share some stories this week from this week. David Kay wrote, "A big tree has fallen in the forest of our lives." Brittany Coleman said, "He really was the heart of MPA." And of course, I got to say this again, be curious. Brittany also told a story about Mr. Groh or Uncle George teaching a class, and he got down to a little piece of chalk and it broke, and he finally said, muttered to himself, went back to the office and got himself a box of new chalk, and he says, "You can't talk without chalk." There may be some truth to that. Michelle Dannenberger said that, and talked about how the students would intentionally ask questions, scientific of course, to try and get him off track, which is so easy to do. And he said that I had ADHD. I'm just, come on now. But they would get him off track. And she said that there was the apple pie incident. And if you know, you know. I need to reach out to her and said, please tell me this story. But she also went on about asking if humans could fly, in which she stopped and went into a lengthy dissertation about the density of bones. And this one's quoted from Uncle George himself. "Petroleum is on everyone's lips." So. I'm going to walk over to this one for a little bit. You've seen this table here. And so I want to share some stories from the table. Jerry Hartman took his advanced biology class. And there was five members in that class. And he said that rather than sit in a classroom, because it was advanced biology after all, they would all pack into the Land Cruiser and they would go up behind the mountain, behind the school, on the mountain behind the school here, and have class in nature as it should be. Uncle George loved his cars, and we were scared to death as children riding with him in the Roadrunner. But he had the FJ40, which he loved, and he had the FJ100. Is that 100? 80, okay, 80. I would get corrected sternly by Uncle George by messing that one up, because on the back of his Land Cruiser, it says genuine SUV. And if you know, you know. But Uncle George and Aunt Linda came out to see us last September, and I had just gotten my Land Cruiser back. It's an 86, and he had so much fun driving it up in the mountains and showing me how to drive it now that everything was fixed on it. I do love the story about the birds, because I remember him being so upset about losing that life list. And of course, he never went anywhere without his binoculars. In fact, when he came to my daughter's wedding this summer of 2022, they brought their binoculars, and after the wedding, went down to one of the state parks to see if they could see some birds that weren't on their life list yet. Brenda Keller talked about how back in her time, you know, there was not Google yet, and so you actually had to learn all these things on your own because you couldn't listen, you look them up later. And so he made them memorize the bird calls. And she says, "The red-eyed vireo, look at me up so high." How did I say that? I knew I'd mess this up because I'm not a birder. Of course, I'd lose it right here. Yes, see me up so high. Yes, me. So, and she also talked about somebody getting stuck in quicksand And they ran to get Mr. Groh, Uncle George, because they knew he didn't know what to do. And it's important to note that he didn't help the poor soul out of the quicksand. They were stuck almost up to their waist. Instead, he taught them and told them how to free themselves. Beautiful analogy there, because he taught many, many people how to free themselves. I remember Calvin and Hobbes, his favorite. But more than that was The Far Side. We still talked about The Far Side. Yes, Far Side, his favorite being, one of his favorites being the student raising his hand and saying, "May I be excused from class? My brain is full." That never worked with us, ever. Roadside geology. He had one for every state. And I believe actually he gave me his for Arizona. And he would come out and, of course, enjoy all the geology of where I live, where we live on the reservation there. And I remember the one year he came out and was very impressed with all the cross bedding. Everything was cross bedding, and my kids still talk about the cross bedding when they see it. AV Media, it was Remembrances. Mr. Curran is here, so he'll really appreciate this shirt. This is made by the students. It was back when the computers were finally starting to get a little more technologically advanced, and we were very impressed with this, and they made 1,000 of them. And people commented in all the comments that Mr. Groh always had the Remembrances shirt on. It really meant a lot to him. I'm like, no, we had 1,000 of them. We didn't sell them all. So he literally has 5 or 6. He thinks they're comfortable. So, and I'm sorry to Mr. Curran. I know that left us with a big bill. And then, of course, his bird book went with everywhere with him. I was so happy to find Matthew Malashenko talked about him playing music before each class and that he liked that so much that he did that for years in the school he taught at. And I was so happy to find the 1812 overture, because when he got this on his big sound system, he played it, and he rattled the windows every single time, and they would tell you about when they recorded this, they used real cannons, and they blew out the windows at such and such. It shouldn't be a surprise, too, that we found Peter, Paul, and Mary, and, of course, if you knew Uncle George, you knew he loved Jerry Clower, so... Jerry Clower had a devotional book, and he read it one summer for the students. Slides, lots and lots of slides are in his life, both at Pisgah and at his house. You talked about Milbourne's. I'm so happy when I found this. Still love playing this. Of course, you know, George Groh, professor of science. He certainly was. And people wrote about their experiences. James Johnson was never his teacher, but he helped him as a child to skin a rattlesnake for a science project. And we always, if you were related to him, if we were his nephews or nieces, we always had the coolest science projects at school because Uncle George would help us find something cool that would make everybody else ooh and ah. From making a can, implode on itself to playing with dry ice, things they'd never let us do these days. Even after retirement, he went out and worked with homeschoolers to teach them science. In the back, there's a thank you card that they wrote, a bunch of seventh graders wrote to Uncle George. Even when he came to the reservation, taught the students there that were homeschooled geology. Of course, you know that he liked rocks, not as much as I do, he liked rocks. And when he was out on the reservation, he went out with me and my son and hunted carnelian agate. And this was the last time we hunted rocks together in South Carolina at Diamond Hill Mine. He brought this home. And of course, probably most likely illegally, brought home some petrified wood there. George and Linda love to hike. That's an observation point in Zion. and had to bring his sunglasses. He went on and told me that I live in a high altitude and I should always wear sunglasses to protect my eyes. Then who can forget the red jacket? Roll call at Pisgah at alumni weekend. I got to bring this up because people would talk about their jackets. He encouraged them to take off the jacket when they get in to acclimate because he kept his room at the same temperature all the time, which is probably why half of us slept. It was either too hot or too cold. It never was just right. But he would tell people to not drink caffeine, that you should drink a lot of water every day because cold water wakes you up better than caffeine. He would drink, when he would come out to see us, he'd have his leaders, it was always in leaders, by the way, because he could never figure out why in the world anyone ever went with the standard system when there's this beautiful metric system that made sense. I had the privilege of sending Uncle George the skit that Nate Bargatze did on Saturday Night Live about the metric system, and he absolutely loved it. He says, finally, yes, I empathize. I agree with this man. Look it up. It's worth it. Forget me not, his flowers, and honestly, the love of his life, Aunt Linda. I put this up here because this was in Aunt Linda's, in Uncle George's closet. We were looking for a few things yesterday, and he had his own little nook there in her closet. It says, "Friends Forever." And this one has choked me up many times over the last few days. He had a picture of Aunt Linda in there, so when he was getting ready every morning, he could see his beautiful bride and be reminded that they truly are friends forever. And what's amazing about Uncle George and Aunt Linda, you really couldn't think of one without the other. They just went everywhere together. And I think they're a great example of what a marriage should be. Loving, considerate. I never, ever saw Uncle George talk harshly to her. And I only saw him consider her feelings in all things. This is Uncle George's first guitar. I want to pick it up, but I don't want to damage it. If you know me, you'll understand why. I was not born with the gift of gracefulness. But this was his first guitar, and it's so amazing that his hands played this, and that's his banjo. And I always wanted to play the banjo because of Uncle George. But these are just memories, that are part of our lives now. By the way, what is this? It's not a wrinkled up piece of paper, I'll just say that. Right here is his Bible. I should say one of his Bibles, because when I went to ask for one of Uncle George's Bible, it was basically, which one do you want? Because he had every version, every translation. And I appreciate the fact that he liked this translation, especially it was the Clear Word Bible, because he never liked the text, the least of these. He never liked that saying because he felt when you said the least of these, it marginalized people more. And so he always liked the version that said the overlooked and forgotten. And some would say that my uncle was woke. People would say, your uncle, he really is up on all this stuff. But I would actually say that my uncle, because he loved Jesus so much, was a reflection of Christ. I would say that my uncle was Christ-like because he truly, truly, truly was concerned for people who were marginalized and overlooked and forgotten. And we would talk for hours. I would call. I had this routine. I walked to work, and so I call my sister, Anjanette, and then I call my sister, Leanne, and I call a buddy of mine, and then I call Aunt Linda and Uncle George. That's my week. And every week I enjoyed talking with Uncle George. And we never had enough time to talk. But we always came back to the theme of Christ and loving others and caring for others. And he did have a deep desire for others to know the love of Jesus. Not that the world, and this is important, not the Jesus that the world teaches, especially today, but the Jesus who touched lives, was tender, personable, intentional in touching people's lives, going where no one else wanted to go, and showing up at the right time to touch a life so that they would know that Jesus loved them. And that was Uncle George. Just want to share a few other memories. Uncle George and Aunt Linda actually rescued my wife and I during the blizzard of 93, and including our ferrets. He was kind enough to come into the house and wrap my fish tank in hopes that maybe the fish would survive the cold and the outage of the electricity. And I'll never forget Uncle George walking out into that blizzard and taking three steps and completely disappearing. And we had to call back out to him and literally hold each other's hands as we walked back to his Land Cruiser. Just after I got married, this is a famous story. My wife and kids are watching. I'm going to tell on myself. Just after we got married in April, and the Remembrances show was about a month and a half later, maybe not even been that. And as usual, we were trying to frantically get done with the slideshow. And so I was working late in the Fleetwood building and was exhausted and sat down. My dear wife woke up the next morning, and I was not in bed beside her, and she panicked. She called my father, hadn't seen him, so she called Uncle George because she figured he'd know where I was, and said, "Have you seen him?" And he says, "I haven't, but I'll go look for him." And he went down to the Remembrances studio and found me sound asleep on the couch. Mark Kendall, your story was easy, buddy. I got my first marriage lesson from my uncle, and he suggested highly that if I wanted to have a successful marriage, I ought not to do that again. And I took that advice and remind my wife every time she likes to bring up the story that I did learn from it. I want to finish with this. My sister wrote this. A pivotal person in my life is now gone. It's going to be strange without Uncle George here. I've never had a time in my life when he wasn't here. He was our Google in the 70s. If my brother and I had a question about something, we knew Uncle George would have the answer. In my mind's eye, I see him in a pair of striped bell-bottom pants driving his yellow Roadrunner, which would scare the daylights out of me with its speed, or the speed he would drive it. I remember my brother wanting him to ride my tricycle. And I remember he did, of course, with his long, skinny legs sticking out of the sides, pedaling it around the carport. We loved it. He was... it was so very different because all three of us siblings had him for a teacher for 4 years. Even my daughter did when he taught some at the grade school. Not only was he my teacher, he was my boss for 2 years. I was his reader, and because he always had so many things going on in his head, I would often have to chase him down to remind him of an upcoming test or whatever. He was an absent-minded professor, not to be shocking on that. He was a good boss, and I felt it was a privilege to get to be his reader. We had many in-depth conversations over the year. He liked to understand some subjects and viewpoints and why people saw or experienced things the way they did. I guess it was curiosity for the understanding he wanted And that was always pretty awesome to me. I often ask him for advice, and he would actually ask me for advice. I always appreciated him, and I always felt he respected me. He even taught me how to drive a stick shift with my new Accord in the church parking lot because my dad was just couldn't handle it. There are so many things I've experienced with Uncle George over the last 56 years. So many. But I know that he was a God-fearing Christian man, even without ever saying so. Like my dad, no announcements of his status had to be made. Actions speak louder than words is one of the truest statements when it came to both my dad and my Uncle George. It's going to be yet another adjustment in this life I wish I didn't have to make, to figure out how to navigate life missing another important person, feeling the huge void that is left. I've come to realize that the bigger void someone leaves just means that you love them that much more. He took care of Aunt Linda with so much love and care through some of the most serious illnesses without ever complaining. Please remember Aunt Linda through these times. August would have been their 56th wedding anniversary. And 56 years ago this August, they arrived at MPA to teach for so many years, for so many kids, and then their kids, and on and on. He loved the students. He loved teaching. It is who he was. Please pray for our family as we learn to navigate a new normal. It's going to be hard for Aunt Linda. She lost her life buddy for now. She'll see him again, and he'll have no more pain, sickness, or sadness. But we must wait for the day when we all get to see our missing loved ones again. I just want to finish with this thought. Over the last 8 or 9 years, the world's become meaner. And Uncle George is one of the few people I knew that every year you knew him, he became sweeter. He became kinder. He became more intentional. And when we lost our dad, I didn't think anybody could ever replace him, and you couldn't, but Uncle George was a wonderful surrogate father to myself and to Anjanette and to Leanne, and I've heard all my cousins say the same thing this week, that Uncle George was a wonderful father to me. I've had students write me and say, Mr. Groh was a wonderful father figure to me. And when I lost my mom, Aunt Linda became a wonderful mother figure to me and the rest of my sisters. So keep them in your prayers. And I do long for the day that we don't have to do this anymore. It means so much that you guys have all come. And I want to also say that I appreciate Uncle George and Aunt Linda's intentionality with my children and with all my sisters and cousins' children. Uncle George and Aunt Linda have loved my kids for who they are. And that's so important, because in this world today, I don't know if I can say this. There are people who hate my daughter, and he just loved her, and that means so much, because she hasn't seen Jesus by other people. But Uncle George and Aunt Linda have shown her Jesus. And he has loved my kids unconditionally, just like he did so many students. And I'll finish by saying this. In the Navajo culture, goodbye is hagane. And it doesn't mean goodbye. It means until next time, until we see each other again. And I'm so thankful that when I learned my uncle died, that I never for one moment was worried about seeing him again. And that's the greatest testimony that anyone can give. And I appreciate this time, and thank you for letting me speak.
Thank you, John. Many of you know who I am, but I don't know who many of you are. I just want to say that it has been a privilege to be here. I've seen some of my former classmates here already, and knowing, as it's been shared already, that we are returning here, it's encouraging to know that you are all here. You'll learn more about that later. One can write down a lot of notes and ideas, but you never know what's going to happen until you're there. You've heard an awful lot of memories, and I'm sure that for each one of you, there has been something that's been said here already that hits home, something that you personally have experienced. Talk about it. Tell each other. There's not enough time in the next month for us to share all the stories, but there's time to keep talking and keep sharing and keep living. I want to fill in some gaps here for you. I laid on an old roll-up bed in a carport, Southern California. Looked out at the street. It was about 2:30 in the morning. I hadn't been in bed very long. And I laid there and watched the cars go by and thought, you know, there's got to be something better than this. I didn't know what it was. I stand before you today alive. If George and Linda had not been willing, I would probably not be alive today. You've heard that they refused a call to Far Eastern Academy. They refused that call because of the potential of me living with them. I met George for the first time when I was 7 years old. And 8 years later, moved into his house. I have interacted with George up until a week ago Monday, almost every week for the last 44 years. And then you folks would be able to enjoy them here for 9 months out of the year, and then we would steal them. And they would be at our place. There were many things there that I could share with you. The expeditions, the chances to get life birds that we were able to fulfill. The stories could go on. But what I want to bring out to you today links back very clearly to the last 44 years of conversation. George was human. He was broken like all of us. Did we have misunderstandings over the years? Oh, yes. Were there times that he was upset with me? Oh, yeah. Were there times I was upset with him? You bet. But there was something about those times that is actually more precious than anything else. We remained. He never gave up on me, and I never gave up on him. We remained. I want you to look at this picture here. I tried for 5 years to get George and Linda to this place. And we finally succeeded this last summer, and I know you have probably heard some stories about that. Because I don't think they could come back from any summer trip without sharing their experiences and their stories with you. This is not a sunset. This is sunrise. They got to see, not this particular one, but they got to see these sunrises for 2 weeks. And I am so thankful that we were finally able to work that out. What we're experiencing here today is not a sunset. It is a sunrise. Because just right there, the sun is just about ready to dawn. That's where we are with George right now. This is where we are in Earth's history right now. We are just about to see the sun. So it's not necessarily a time for us to look gloomy, but to know it's closer. It's closer. Now, I have been to hell. In fact, I've made the trip several times. And I know what it looks like. I know what it feels like. I know what it smells like. I know what it sounds like. And that time each trip is required, it's less easier. It's harder to make that trip. Now, you think, this guy's off his rocker. Is he still doing drugs? Now, we have to understand what that word means, hell. It doesn't mean a place. It means a condition. It means to be separated. That is hell. And I want you to see that George is physically separated from us right now. and it hurts. We will miss him, and we do miss him. But I want to tell you that the separation that George has from us right now is the best form of separation we can experience in this life as a fallen world. He had an incredible life, and he has the best form of separation from us that we can ever, ever experience. And I'm sure that he would say, "Don't cry for me. Don't cry for me." There is a form of separation that is the hardest type of separation possible. And that's to experience separation and still be alive. Every one of you in this room has experienced separation, and you're still walking around. You're still living. You're still breathing. Now, we've heard the term the walking dead. We're the living separated. Separation among ourselves, among our families, separation within our churches, separation in whatever venue. Is a living hell. I've watched George weep in trying to find ways that he can help some people in situations come back together. I have watched him work to connect back with myself, and I learned how to connect back with him. I saw how deeply it affected him in his heart to see the separation take place between living beings. And there are many other stories. As Linda and I have read things and listened over this last week of how many people he reached out to that he was sure he had offended and hurt. The living separation always comes with pain. Always comes with pain. But there's something quite interesting in that when what is separated is put back together, you also experience pain. And it's often that pain that we step back from because we don't want to feel it, because it hurts. But what comes when we experience that pain is a connection that is much stronger than what we had before. The worst pain is the silence of living separated in shame. Is not what Christ intended for us to have. And George hated separation. You've heard the phrase, love the sinner, but hate the sin. Have you ever really wondered what was meant by that? Were you, I'm supposed to hate this thing over here or that thing over there or what I'm doing here or what you're doing over there? There's good things that I need to like and there's bad things that I need to hate. No. What that means is to hate separation in any form you find it. Do you hate sin? I hate it with a passion. And I know that George hated separation with a passion. That's why he did what he did here for so long. Because there was always more to do. We are hurting way beyond in our lives the death of George himself. And what I want to pass on to you through the many, many hours of our conversations is that he wanted to make peace. He wanted to make peace. If you open your Bibles to Matthew chapter 5, this is the chapter where Jesus gave what we call the Beatitudes. I don't think Jesus ever called them that. We call it that. But I want you to see something here. This is jumped out at me years ago, and I always go back to look at this because it's such a draw. Starting in verse 3, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. But I won't take the time to read them all here, but I want you to see this. The first one, the result of being poor in spirit is that you will receive the kingdom of heaven. If you mourn, you will be comforted. If you are meek, you'll inherit the earth. And if you're hungry for righteousness, you will be filled. Verse 7, if you're merciful, you'll receive mercy. If you are pure in heart, you'll get to see God. Verse 10 says, if you're persecuted for my sake, yours is the kingdom of heaven. But I skipped one. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Notice this. You get the kingdom of heaven. You get comforted. You get filled. You inherit the earth. You obtain mercy. You will see God. You will get the kingdom of heaven. But the peacemaker gets to be called the Son of God. That is the most relational, connected term you can ever imagine. George was a peacemaker. George was a peacemaker. Now, I want to be clear here. It's not peacekeeping. Do you know the difference? Now I'm going to use an uncomfortable term. You've heard the phrase, a kept woman. Another way that we would say it is mistress. Someone who is only there for another person. Now, she's isolated. She's separated. doesn't necessarily have her own life. Peace is no different. No different than that. If we have kept peace, peace is dead. It has no life. It doesn't grow. And almost always we keep the peace for someone else's purpose other than our own or as a community. George made peace. And peace that is made is dynamic. It's moving, it's growing, it's resolving, it's freeing, it's enlightening. And I have experienced this with George over the years. And I know that he was that to you as well. I will greatly miss our conversations. That's a hole that will not be easily filled. I've kind of coined a new term here, I guess. We were good at that. We would come up with words that didn't exist. How many times? And Linda still participates in that game. George was an anti-separationist. You've heard of separatist movements, be they political, religious, whatever the spectrum. This is not that. An anti-separationist. He was against separation. And like I said, he has the best separation any of us could hope for. I can live with that because I know God's got him in his memory. I know that there's an expiration date on what we struggle with in this life. That's coming. But in the meantime, God has asked us to connect with each other. Years of separation within families, years of separation within our churches, years of pain is before you right now to end the living hells that we all quietly live with. And I know that George would want that to take place. And because he's affected you, and because he's affected me, that opportunity, believe me, is waiting and living within you. Will you participate in that? Our times of being able to relate and interact and talk with George are over. But the opportunity to interact and relate and talk and get real and get honest with each other is right in front of us. That is what George would want. That is what George would want. I want to, you heard something fall on the floor up here earlier. I'm going to do something you might not be able to see, but I'm going to try it. Okay? That's one of the things I learned from George. Well, try it, you know, see what happens. It's kind of how I live every day, because the time you get nailed with problems that you don't have ready solutions for. Well, let's try this. Let's figure it out. So I'm going to try this. Now, what I have in my hand is a Yellowstone River Montana moss agate. Anybody heard of those before? Yeah. Okay. This is what everybody, you know, that wants to go rock hounding, and I was born into a family of rock hounds, and it's hard to get rid of the disease. This is what's called a limb cast. It forms in the shape left behind in lava or basalt of a tree when it was engulfed in a volcanic situation. The tree rots or is burned away, and it leaves a cavity in the rock. But because of this new rock and the water tables that rise within it, that those waters are super saturated with silicates. And because of the heat and the pressure and the volume, or the what they would call the load of mineral in the water, it deposits into these incredibly beautiful agates. Now, what I'm holding up here, it looks dark, doesn't it? You know, it's just a rock. Now, it's had a surface on it polished. Now, I've got a flashlight here, and I'm going to shine it on here, and I hope you can see it. I'm going to leave it up here, so if you want to come and look at it afterwards, please do. Hands-on, that was one of the big things, right? Now, does it look dark anymore? Can you see that? What color do you see? It's kind of blue, isn't it? Okay? So if it's just a rock and it's hard and it's cold and it just looks dark, but light shines on it, it changes. Now it's blue. But I want to take it a step farther. Now, I polished a little window on the side of this agate. If I take the flashlight and I put it direct, now what do you see? Can you see that? It's not blue anymore. Now, the agates that come, what they call Montana agates, there's no known bed that these come out of where they can say, okay, this is where it comes from, and we'll go there and we'll get it. It's scattered over hundreds of miles of gravel beds. And these gravel beds came from the caldera called Yellowstone. But they're all water washed. They're not in situ or in the actual matrix of the rock that they were formed in. All of that's gone and washed away. These are all rounded. They've been tumbled, but there's something that's interesting. They're all fractured. Very few of these are not fractured. Now, if you notice, the light only goes kind of partway through. The fractures stop the light. George was fractured. I'm fractured. We're all fractured. We can sit here today and be out in the cold and in the dark, or we can sit here today and have the light shining on us. But that light means nothing unless the light shines through us. You notice the color of the light shining through? The color of blood. The blood of Christ is what shines through us. George had a lifelong commitment to letting the light shine through him. Now, I'll finish it this way. And you might think, okay, Cliff, this is enough. We've listened enough. You guys are probably saddle sore already. I'm sorry. But this will bring this to, I think, a neat way of looking at it. And it came to me, believe it or not, in my reading of an interview with a Satanist. And I was surprised that I could learn something from a Satanist. When asked about worshiping Satan, the Satanist responded with this. He says, this is what everybody gets wrong. A Satanist doesn't worship Satan. A Satanist is someone who does what Satan does. He worships himself. Do I just say that I worship Jesus Christ? Or do I do what he does? To mend the brokenhearted, to feed the poor, to reach out to my neighbor, even though they may be a Samaritan. What about the person you're separated with? Or maybe to the person who separated you? Am I reaching out? Am I doing what Jesus did? And am I doing what Jesus does? And I think this is the, if I could condense George's life down to one thing, it would be that. That he did as best he knew how to let the light shine through him to you and to me. I want to do what Jesus does. I want to do what Jesus did. And I want to live forward. This is pre-dawn. This is looking forward to the day. George would say, and I know this for a fact, he says, don't do it just because I do. Don't do it just because I see it that way. You look at this and you study it for yourself. And I know that he would say, don't emulate me. I'm broken. I want to emulate Christ. George would want you to emulate Christ. Let's live forward from today. Let's not look back. Let's remember those wonderful times that we talked, those wonderful times that we argued, those wonderful times we made up, those wonderful times we sought, how can we find something better? I'll close with this one story. It was about 15 years ago. George and Linda had come. They took care of you during the school year. We took care of them during the summer. And I said, George, I was thinking that I had never fully ever said thank you to you. I said, you know, you guys did so much for me when you didn't have to. And he looked at me and he said, I didn't do anything for you. George, you bought me clothes. You fed me a lot. I mean, you saw me through at all your own expense for 4 years. And you're going to tell me you did nothing for me? He said, yeah, that's what I'm going to tell you. And I said, I don't get it. He said, if you had not been looking for something better, I could have done nothing for you. He said, you did it yourself. Do you want something better? I do. I want connection. I want relationship. I want to be one with my family, my fellow human beings. And I know that's what George would want. Emulate Christ. Don't emulate him. And in closing, he was a brother. He was a father. But just like Bilbo Baggins at the end of his adventure, and he's trying to get into his own house, and they have to ask him who he is, and who he hands him a piece of paper, and it has the name Thorin Oakenshield on it. And they said, well, who is this? Prove yourself. There was only one thing Bilbo could say. He was my friend. He was my friend. People, grace be with you. Let's go forward. And I want you to do something, and this is my challenge. I want you to grieve, and I want you to grieve well. Grieve well. Talk, share, and don't hold back. And I'm thankful for John, Kitty, and John, who could stand up here and cry, because this is what we need to do to heal. And let's cry with each other for each other. There will be a time coming when we will never be able to do that again. Let's grieve well.
Thank you, Cliff. I just want to encourage you today as you think about grieving. Well, the Bible says we can grieve as those who have hope. And I pray today that Jesus can give each one of us hope that we will indeed have a great reunion day. Jesus is coming again. And the Bible tells us in 1 Thessalonians 4 that there will be a shout, voice of an archangel, the trumpet will sound, and the dead in Christ will rise first. And we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them to meet them in the clouds, and thus we shall always be together, no more separation, hallelujah, together forever. And in that twinkling of an eye, we shall be transformed. And there'll be that day, Revelation says, when he'll wipe every single tear from our eyes. No more pain, no more sorrow, no more death. That is the dawn that we get to look forward to soon and very soon when Jesus returns. I just want to leave you with an image that I had when I first met George 15 years ago this May. We interviewed here in the sanctuary, and there comes that moment where the pastor leaves and somebody shows the pastor what the rest of the church looks like while they talk about you here. And guess who that person was? It was George. And George, not only taking my wife and I around here, but my one-year-old son in George's arms. That was my introduction to George. And I think in that beautiful communication, George would want all of us to not look to him to be the one to carry us, but to look to the everlasting arms of our God to be the one who carries us. And today, if you're looking through your life, and you're thinking of ways that maybe George carried you through many seasons or times in your life, whether as a church member, a family, friend, as a student, as someone who's faculty, staff, a colleague with him. I know George would often tell me, I knew that something touched George's heart if I ever shared a message when he came up to me and just had tears in his eye. He had such a tender heart. And he would just say, thank you for sharing the gospel today. And today that gospel is those everlasting arms are the ones that this very weekend, the larger Christian world, what are we celebrating this weekend? It's Easter. The fact that the one who died for us rose again. And today he is alive and he is for each and every one of us. And he wants to hold Jesus with those nail-scarred hands, hold each one of us in those everlasting arms and to allow them to carry us all the way until the day Jesus comes back again. And we will see George again. And God, I know God is moving upon George's heart with the gospel, and he's wanting to move on our hearts with the gospel at all times. And I know George would want to see each and every one of you. He doesn't want to see any one of you missing on that day. And if we can put our hands in the nail-scarred hands of our Savior, we can be assured that we're going to get there by his amazing grace. And that's one thing I appreciated about George is he loved to talk about grace. So today, may you fall into the arms of our Savior, experience that grace, and may his everlasting arms keep and carry each and every one of you until that day when we see Jesus face to face and we see George once again as well. Hallelujah. I want to invite our men's choir, thank you for being here, to come forward again and share with us the Irish blessing.
This was the last song that we sang with George at our last concert, and I think it's fitting for today.
Pray with me again. Father God, thank you so much for each one that was able to be here this afternoon. We're thankful for those tuning in online, those that will be watching this later. Father, we have come today to honor a gift that you've given to us into our lives. That is the gift of George Grove. I want to pray for Linda, his family. Pray for each one here, friends, students, colleagues, church family, that, Lord, you would indeed hold us in the palm of those nail-scarred hands, hold us up in those everlasting arms. We pray and ask, Father God, that you will Carry us, give us hope in our hearts that Jesus, you are coming soon and very soon. And we long for that day because it will be a day of reunion. And Lord, whatever those memories are that we see of George and remember of George that touched our life, may we honor him by passing that forward to someone else, being the George that he was in our life to someone else as an honor to him. And really, Lord, it's a glimpse of your own heart. Give us that servant's heart that George had. Give us that loving heart. Give us that heart for the gospel. Give us that heart that longs to see you face to face one day soon and very soon. And we know George worshiped you not only as Savior, but as Creator God. And we long for that moment when you will recreate. The dead in Christ will rise again, and you will recreate a new heavens and a new earth in which only righteousness dwells. Lord, may none of us be missing on that day. Fill us with your Spirit. As much as you, God, in your infinite wisdom and the gracious outworkings of your providence, has permitted our dear brother in the Lord, George Grow, to lay down the burdens of this life, to fall asleep in Christ, we do lovingly, in celebration today, commit him to you, our God, in the sure and certain hope of that joyful resurrection when you, our Lord and Savior, shall return in glory. And today we remember that all the issues of life are in your hands, the hands of the everlasting Father of love and compassion. And we thank you today that you have promised eternal life to all those who love you. And we do love you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you again for being here. I want to thank Robert Nunnally for being here, helping out with our visitation time. And he will escort the family out at this time. And Kevin Wirth will be playing as well. And as the family exits, they will have an opportunity to see you in the foyer. I would encourage you that be sensitive to the time, because our deaconesses of the Mount Pisgah Academy Seventh-day Adventist Church have prepared a meal that is probably ready next door for the family there. So visit, share, but also keep in mind sensitivity to the time to them to get over to eat as well. Thank you again. God bless you, and may Jesus come soon.